Well, hi everybody. My name is Paul Fisher from the University of Florida, IFAS Extension, and it's a real pleasure to be together with my good friend Shawn Mallen from AMA Horticulture. A lot of my own work is in container substrates and container nutrition, and a lot of the growth in our industry right now is coming in hydroponic. So I thought I'd go to one of the experts just to talk about some of the options of substrates for horticulture, and had the pleasure of going and visiting grower operations with Shawn in Canada. So I know he's got a lot of expertise to share with us. And Shawn Mallen is the manager for hydroponics and manufacturing at AMA Horticulture. So welcome, Shawn. It's great to see you again.
Yes. Thanks, Paul. You too.
So why don't we leap straight into the topic of the day on choosing substrates for hydroponic production?
Yes. Okay. Sounds good. So like I said, myself, so do have a little bit of a background, been a grower in my, I guess you always call it my previous life. So about 19 years into the greenhouse industry, though it is between flower, potted plants, and at the end was vegetable production and propagation. So wide range of experiences and knowledge, I guess, that's way in the back. But we'll try and bring some of that out today and help with a few things. So we'll just go to this first slide here. And most people would be familiar with these products, but yeah, so coconut and rockwool would be the two things that we're predominantly using in hydroponics. When it comes to cocoa, there's a number of different options. It could be those options on their own or a combination of them. So you have coconut fiber, you have coconut core, coconut peat, and then you also have coconut chips. So sometimes it's just a variation of just cocoa chips or just cocoa peat. But sometimes you get a blend of what you're doing. So depending on the grower and what they're trying to do. Stone wool, rock wool, it's also known as. Similarly there, you have stone wool blocks, plugs, slabs, so you can have the complete system as far as starting out. With that type of product, you're inert, so you're starting, you know, disease-free, no viruses. So from that perspective and a propagator perspective, it's very clean, no dust as far as the cocoa peat or just regular peat moss, so cleanliness facility and things of that nature. So it lends itself very well in that regard. A lot of automation on that side of things. You're able to move material automated. You're able to transplant with automatic transplanters. So there's a lot of upside to that type of system. Then you get into like just regular peat mixes. You have some different perlite and vermiculite, either on their own or as additives in different options. Again, mixes of all sorts. You can mix perlite with cocoa, you can mix perlite with peat. So it really depends on what you want it to do and what you're trying to achieve. And then we see a lot more in the, I guess, the hobby market, the indoor market, would be stuff like clay pellets, perlite. There's a couple of different, you know, foams and things of that nature that are out there as well. So there's still more substrate options than what we're just looking at here. So there's a wide variety of options for growers, but in the hydroponic industry, it's predominantly a cocoa or a rock wool, stone wool option.
So you got those three different types of coconut type products there. I know talking with friends in the peat industry, they don't like that term cocoa peat, but it's something that comes up, right? And I think, is that because it's got more of a blend of small particles and smaller fibers that's got characteristics closer to peat? Is that the...
Yeah, certainly. It'd be it, just because they're trying to relate it to peat, and there'd be smaller fibers. Yeah, traditionally, I mean, if you looked at it from afar, I guess, you want to... So it would be structurally similar to peat moss, but yeah, it's not. And that's why they call it cocoa peat, because when we talk about peat, that's its own thing.
So I'm familiar with, you know, you get all kinds of different particle sizes, and you can have coconut blends with some of these, you know, range of different parts and sizes of the coconut itself in your substrate. How about the stone wool or rock wool type product? Is that all the same, or do you have some options there in terms of any of the physical or chemical properties?
Yeah, again, you would have options, and that would more lend itself to the fiber structure or the fiber density. And then also if it's vertical or horizontal, cross, so they have stuff called cross fiber. So there are a couple of different ways or different options there when growers have at their disposal on what they're doing. Typically, when you start at the plug stage, as you can imagine, you would have a denser product. And as you move up from a slab or from a block and then to a slab, you'd have a little bit less denser and more air porosity in that. But yeah, there's certainly different options, and different companies have different slabs. And every couple of years, you always see something that's marketed new to the industry. So they're always working on it for sure.
These are both fairly inert type materials, right, Shawn? They're not contributing a lot of nutrients themselves?
Yeah, correct. I mean, there's not a lot of value, I guess, from a nutrient perspective, from the plant's point of view, especially when you're getting started with a crop. More or so, I would say the coconut core is just, it'll be more so probably if we look back, you know, 8-10 years ago, is really being aware of where you're getting that in at and what the pH is already at, and if it's washed or buffered. There's, you know, standards now, and predominantly what you see on the market is you will get, for sure, you would have washed core. But a lot of people are also getting washed and buffered. Now, once you start doing the buffering, it can no longer be termed organic. So there's different aspects there on what you want to achieve as a grower and what you're doing as a, in your growing. So it can vary that way, yes. But you're right. They're both kind of, you know, what you feed is what you kind of get. You're going to have some analysis, and depending on what the plant's at and what it's using, and you know, where the plant is at in its life cycle at the start, middle, end, it's producing fruit, you know, flower, it's generative, vegetative. So there's a couple different things to look at there that can alter, but growers really can be precise in what they're doing from the irrigation and fertigation side of things.
Right. So the grower is very much in control of nutrition in terms of pH and EC and the nutrient balance with both of these products. And yes. I think that a lot of the ions that are likely to come into an unwashed coconut product would probably be sodium and potassium chloride. And the buffering that you're talking about, I think that's an interesting point I never thought about, is if you're an organic grower, you need to be careful. Not all core is going to be organically acceptable if it's had calcium nitrate in there, which is designed to flush out some of those other ions. That's going to be a mineral fertilizer source, which wouldn't be organically acceptable.
Yep, correct.
Okay. Yep. And then, you know, you've got quite a range of products that are here. You know, my own work is primarily in containers, so I'm very familiar with peat and perlite and vermiculite blends in a container for an ornamental crop or something along those lines. And you know, I think there's kind of a spectrum here from a substrate that really has a big impact on your growing and your nutrition, like a peat perlite type of mix, which has got limestone in it and going to have some pH buffering from that. It's also got a little bit higher cation exchange capacity. Whereas, again, the coconut and the stonewool type products, they're really there just to support that plant, hold some water, provide some air to the root zone, and it's really in the hands of the grower, which can be good and bad. So you've got to be really on top of your nutrient management if you're doing a hydroponic production system.
Yeah, and what you have to remember is most of your hydroponic crops are much longer in duration versus a potted plant, a bedding plant, things of that nature. Because again, that would be my original experience too with potted plants. So you're planting something up and the life cycle of that plant, say in that pot that it's in, it could be, you know, 8 weeks, 3 months, and that's kind of its life cycle. So the material that you're growing in maybe doesn't have to sustain itself for a longer period of time. Where rock wool, cocoa, things of that nature, they're used for, you know, tomatoes, peppers, you know, cucumbers to a little bit lesser extent, but these are growing for 10, 11 months of the season. So you really need a durable product that's not going to break down. You still want to keep your air as much as you can in those substrate. So you don't want the actual substrate itself breaking down into smaller particles. So that's why these things are being used and just have a longer life cycle within the duration of the crop and more even. So you're getting the same type of performance from the start to the end. The only thing you have added to it would be the root matter. So you can have some organic things going on in that nature, and then your fertigation that you have in there. But generally, that's getting flushed out and constantly being turned over, and the grower is monitoring that. So that's really the growing part that the grower is doing, is the fertigation.
Right, and leaching rates of 10 to 30% are not unknown in a hydroponic system. So that's really turning over that nutrient solution in the root zone.
Yes, often. For sure. I mean, and you're seeing, and you're also watering traditionally from the top down.
Yep, got it.
You do get that in some potted plants, but you also see in the potted plant industry, there's a flood floor system. So you're, everything is being from the bottom. So you're getting that capillary action within traditionally a peat moss mix that's going to be able to do that. Obviously the roots are bringing up the water as well, but more so in a cocoa or the hydroponic situation, everything is top down. Also because the tops generally drier, mm-hmm. bottoms are usually wetter. That can vary between cocoa and rockwall on which one is, you know, drier and wetter, but within the height level of that substrate, there can be differences for sure in wetness or dryness and, you know, your air
right. So this container height part is really important. There's going to be drier at the top, wetter at the bottom. You don't want these substrates sitting in water, do you?
Correct.
You have them free draining. And especially with rockwall, you're going to see a big difference between the moisture level at the bottom compared with the top.
We can move a little bit if that's kind of enough on substrates. Again, this is maybe on a crop basis. So we see different things for different crops, I guess. Traditionally, tomatoes is you would see on stonewall quite often. So not to say that you won't see cocoa or you won't see other, but that would be the traditional way. Cucumbers are more apt to be on a rockwall substrate. We see a lot of pepper growers lean more towards a cocoa substrate. And then lettuce, you get into different peats, and you also get into different stonewall again. That could vary on if it's NFT or if it's a floating system. Strawberries, we get into more complex mixtures that have a variations of sizes of fractions with some perlite, so you see more mixes in that type of a setting. So it kind of varies by crop, but there is no one set of rules that say, well, you know, stonewall is always used for tomatoes, or you know, we only use mixes for strawberries because you can use cocoa, you can use rockwall, and vice versa. So there's lots of options out there.
So I've heard about disposal issues for rockwall. Is that a major challenge and one of the big reasons to think about choosing rockwall, stonewall compared with coconut core, or are there disposal issues for both?
For sure, there's disposal issues for both. Yep. So that, I guess that's an ongoing thing that you see, each of its own, I guess, that has their own solutions to them. We're kind of not part of that life cycle, but we're certainly part of the input side, so we pay attention to those things. But in the end, it becomes, what's the story that the grower can tell? You're still, either way, you're saving lots of water. So what are you comparing it to is the big thing. So yes, there is some waste, but you know, there might be more waste if you're using something different. A lot of your input costs, you have to remember all the water savings and all the nutrient savings that you're getting from going from a traditional, you know, farming system into an actual hydroponic system. A lot of these places are recirculating their irrigation. You know, you're basically growing pesticide free. So to me, there's a lot more pluses than those negatives, but it's still an issue and it's constantly being worked on, and growers are always asking for the solution, but I guess the solution's still in progress.
Is there a cost difference between coconut core versus rockwall, stonewall, Shawn, or are they pretty similar?
They're very competitive, yes, with each other.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
There's probably some minor differences, and again, it depends on, because it's never really apples to apples necessarily, but it's very competitive.
Okay. So. And you mentioned about strawberries. I don't know anything about growing strawberries in greenhouses, but were you saying that it'd be more often that you might have some peat type substrates in there, or is it still mostly coconut core or rockwall? What kind of growing mix is used?
Yeah, I mean, we have a couple of different blends that we offer, but by far the most popular one and the one that's used more widely would be actually a mix of coconut with some peat, and the peat has different sizes of fractions in it, and with a mixture of perlite. So the combination of those three elements with the different size fractions of the peat really is the best of everything. We do have some mixes that are just different peat fractions. There are mixes out there that you can do that are just core. There are people growing strawberries on rockwall, stonewall, so all things are possible. Okay. But for us here, it's a combination blend that we offer, and that seems to be a great success with the growers that we have, for sure.
Okay. And then if we're looking over at floating system, deep water culture, or if we're an NFT. Rockwall is a stabilized product. It holds itself together. It's not going to have any particles going into the water, I don't think.
And yeah, that's nutrient solution. Going to be the big key. Yeah.
In container production for transplants, we use peat polymer mixes, grow coons, allopots, a whole bunch of different jiffies, a bunch of different stabilized type products. Are they widely used for a lettuce crop, for example, or what's the most
common? Yeah, exactly. You're exactly correct. I mean, you see a lot of stone wool, rock wool in that, and then because basically you want something that's going to retain its shape and its structure, but also because you're recirculating and you're either in a pond or NFT, which has water flowing by. So there's a lot of filtration in those systems. So the less particles you have moving through your system, the cleaner it's going to be. So that's one issue that growers would have. Yeah, there's lots of foam products, lots of glue with peat, different recipes. There's also, you can buy, you know, little cups and containers. And then in that regard, you can put whatever mix you want in them. Some of those containers can be degradable. Some are, you have your pots, you know, net pots, slip pots that you can put lots of stuff in. So it really varies. And again, it goes back to, you know, are you selling a live lettuce or a live plant? Or is it a cut plant? And, you know, yeah, what's the story? Is it an organic? Is it hydroponic? Is it, so what's your customer base, or what is your customer, or whoever your market is going to, what's their preference, right?
Okay, got it. Thank you.
We don't really maybe get into too much with this one, but also your microgreens and different things of that nature. We've seen a lot of, you know, increase in requests and questions, and, you know, people trying to understand what that's all about, even from a small scale to a quite large scale as well. We have some like Rockwall options that are basically needle felted fabric that is available. You see a lot on, you know, thin layers of peat and things of that nature in, you know, in a tray. Again, some people are selling it as, you know, it would be live microgreens, so it might be sold already in the clamshell or in the tray. So just to comment on, I guess it was about, you know, the air, so you can have the same pot, same container. This is true of flowers, same of, doesn't matter really what the product is, if, even if it is a rock wool or cocoa. Sometimes when you get those type of materials in a bag, they're pretty uniform, so you're getting consistency. So as you can see here, I think it'll display a little bit. So you can have the exact same volume of substrate in the container, but if one is a lot more compressed, obviously you're gonna have less air, less room for, you know, roots to grow. So really when you're any type of system you're talking about, even if you're container filling, you know, buckets or what have you, that having that even dispersion of everything really makes a difference. Just this picture alone, you really don't have to have a lot of comments on it because it's the same size pot, same plants, you know, it's the same planting date, everything's the same. You can see the one on the left has a lot more weight, you know, 160 grams per liter of soil. The one on the right is 130 grams per liter.
Very good. Well, I think we covered a lot of great topics. I really appreciate it, Shawn, and you shared a lot of your knowledge and expertise today. And I look forward to the day, hopefully soon, that we're able to go out and visit a grower together again.
Yeah, that would be great. Appreciate it, Paul.
All right. Thank you.
Take care.